The starship, for reasons that had to do with the politics of appropriations, was named the SS Senator Joseph S. Holloway. But the press and the public called her Big Joe. Her captain, six-star Admiral Heselton, thought of her as Great Big Joe and never fully got over being awestruck at the size of his command.
She's a mighty big ship, Rodgers.
Yes, sir.
He spoke proudly to the navigator, ignoring the latter's rather vacant stare and fixed smile.
More than a mile long and wider than hell.
Yes, sir.
Swiveling his chair around, Heselton slowly surveyed the ship's control room with a small, satisfied smile. Rodgers, sitting far forward, almost surrounded by his navigational console. Sergeant Widman, idly running tactical scenario analysis at his computer. And just behind, the communications officer, Lieutenant Galway, as usual, on headsets listening. For weeks now, as Big Joe moved across the galaxy's uncharted fringe, the communication bands had been completely dead, except, of course, for the usual star static hissing and burbling in the background. Turning back again to his navigator, Heselton smiled and noted that Big Joe was indisputably the largest, most powerful, most feared, and most effective spaceship in the known universe. Big Joe, armed with all the best weaponry known to Earth technology, was literally the battleship to end all battleships. Ending battleships and battles was, in fact, her job, and she did it well. With a relaxed sigh, Heselton leaned back to gaze at the stars and contemplate the vastness of the universe.
A signal, Captain! Damn close on the VHF band! Their transmission is completely overriding the background noise. Here, have a listen.
The communications officer toggled a switch, and an overhead speaker came to life, emitting a distinct clacking grunting sound.
It's audio of some sort, sir, but there's a lot more to the signal than that.
In one motion, Heselton's chair snapped forward, his right fist hit the red emergency alert button on his desk, and his left snapped on the ship's intercom.
This is your captain. Red alert. All stations, red alert. Lieutenant Galway, contact radar and report.
Lights dimmed momentarily as powerful emergency drive units snapped into action, and the ship echoed with the sound of 2,000 men running to battle stations.
Sir, radar reports all clear.
What?
Radar to bridge repeats. All clear, Captain. Sir, we've got two men on every scope. There's nothing anywhere. Wait. Radio track is reporting. Sir, Doppler calculations show that the source of those signals is slowing down somewhere to our right. It's acting like a spaceship, sir, that's coming to a halt.
The captain locked eyes with Rodgers for a second, then shrugged.
Rodgers, slow the ship and circle right.
Yes, sir.
Lieutenant Galway, tell radio track to keep us posted on the object's position.
It's still off to our right, but that's the best we can say.
Sir?
Yes, Sergeant.
We've managed to get our rangefinders on something. It's either directly right or directly left of the ship, matching speed with us exactly.
Either to our right or left?
That's the best we can do, sir.
Captain, sir?
Please give me something I can use, Galway.
Judging from the frequency and strength, we think it's probably less than 100 miles away.
Less than 100 miles away?
Of course, we can't be positive, sir.
Galway, that thing is practically on our necks. What the hell's the matter with that equipment?
Can't help it, Captain. The equipment is working perfectly. We've tried the complete range of frequencies. We're going blind looking. There's absolutely nothing. Nothing at all.
For a moment, the bridge was silent, except for the clacking grunting from the overhead speaker, which, if anything, sounded louder than before.
Sir, it's television, sir. We've unscrambled the image. Here, have a look.
The communication screen glowed for a moment, then flashed into life. The figure was clearly alien, though humanoid at least from the waist up, which was all that showed on the screen. A large mouth and slightly bulging eyes gave it a somewhat jovial, frog-like demeanor. Seated at a desk similar to Heselton's, wearing a gaudy uniform profusely strewn with a variety of insignia, it was obviously Heselton's counterpart, the commander of an alien vessel.
Looks like we've contacted a new race. Let's return the call, Lieutenant.
Yes, sir.
A tiny red light glowed beneath a miniature camera on Heselton's desk, and almost at once the alien's face registered obvious satisfaction. It waved a six-fingered hand in an unorthodox but friendly greeting. Heselton waved back. The alien then pointed to his mouth, made several clacking, grunting sounds, and moved a hand on his desk. The scene switched to another alien standing in front of what looked like a blackboard, with a piece of chalk in his hand. The meaning was clear.
Lieutenant Galway, have this transmission switched to the linguistics section. Maybe those guys can work out some sort of language.
The screen blanked out. Heselton leaned back, tense, obviously worried.
People, there's a ship right next door somewhere that should stand out like King Kong in a kindergarten.
But, Captain, our optical equipment isn't designed for close-range work. We've been doing the best we can. Tried everything from infrared through ultraviolet. If there is a ship out there, I'm afraid it's invisible.
Beads of sweat sprinkled Heselton's forehead.
This is bad. Mighty bad.
Nervously, he walked across to the right of the bridge and stood, hands clasped behind his back, staring blankly out at the blackness and the scattered stars.
I know there is a ship out there, and I know that a ship simply can't be invisible, not to radar and optics.
What makes you sure there's only one, sir?
My God, Rodgers, you're right. There might be...
A development, sir. I think we've got something on the radiation detectors.
Good work. What did you find?
Slight radioactivity, typical of interstellar drive mechanisms, somewhere off to our right. Can't tell exactly where, though.
How far away is it?
I don't know, sir.
Thanks. Thanks for the help.
The screen flashed into life with a picture of the smiling alien commander.
Sir, the linguistics section report the aliens understand a fairly common galactic symbology. I believe we can translate, on the fly, simple messages for you now.
Good. Ask him where the hell he is.
It was a request the captain instantly regretted as the alien's face showed unmistakable surprise. The alien commander's smile grew into an almost unbelievable grin. He turned sideways to speak to someone out of sight of the camera and suddenly burst into a series of roaring cackles.
He's laughing, sir.
The joke was strictly with the aliens. Heselton's face whitened.
Rodgers, they didn't know that we can't see them.
Look, sir.
The navigator pointed to the view screen and a brilliantly clear image of Big Joe shimmering against the galaxy, lit by millions of stars. Every missile port, even the military numerals along her nose, were clearly visible.
They're rubbing it in, Captain, showing us what we look like to them.
Heselton's face was chalk.
They could blast Big Joe apart, piece by piece. The most powerful ship in the galaxy.
Maybe, sir, the second most powerful.
Without answering, Heselton turned and looked out again at empty space and millions of steady, unwinking stars. His mind formed an image of a huge ethereal spaceship, missile ports open, weapons aimed directly at Big Joe.
Captain, sir, with your permission, I'll scatter a few C-bombs.
Are you out of your mind? We haven't the slightest idea of the forces that guy has. We might be in the center of a whole bloomin' fleet.
The alien's face, still smirking, appeared again on the screen.
He says, sir, that he finds the presence of our armed ship here very annoying.
Tell him that we apologize. This part of the galaxy is strange to us.
He says he is contemplating blasting us into oblivion.
Heselton said nothing. But he longed to reach out and throttle the grinning alien face.
However, sir, he says he will let us go safely if we leave immediately. He says to send an unarmed diplomatic vessel next time, and maybe his people will talk to us.
Heselton's jaws clenched so tightly they ached.
Thank him for his kindness.
He says, sir, to get the hell out now.
The grinning face snapped off the screen, but the cackling laughter continued to reverberate in the control room until the communications officer finally turned off the receiver.
Reverse course. Maximum drive.
Yes, sir.
Hundreds of gyros swung the mile-long ship end for end and stabilized her on a reverse course. Drive units big enough to power several major cities whined into operation. Anti-grav generators with the strength to shift small planets counterbalance the external acceleration, and the ship moved away with a speed approaching that of light.
Well, that's the very first time Big Joe has ever had to retreat.
As if it were his own personal failure, he walked slowly across the control room and down the corridor towards his cabin. Lost in thought, Heselton barely heard the call of the ship's communications officer running up, waving two large photographs. Pausing at the door to his cabin, Heselton turned to face the woman.
Captain, look. Look, sir. We first thought this was a spot on the photographic lens, but one of the men got curious and enlarged it a couple of hundred times.
She held up one of the photos. It showed a small, fuzzy, but unmistakable spaceship.
No wonder we couldn't spot it with our instruments.
Heselton snatched it out of her hand.
I see what you mean. This ship must have been thousands of miles...
No, sir. As a matter of fact, it was quite close by.
But what... How?
We figure that the total length of the alien ship was roughly an inch and a half.